part of the Kateri Aaron organization.
Yeah.
And it's dedicated to preserving the Irish music, dance, and language. How important is that? So, they want to know a little further, but see them again. They do two sessions a month.
First Tuesday of the month.
First Tuesday of the month, they're at the Nail Creek in Utica, and the third Tuesday, they're at Stockdale's in Riskany. And a very kind of short, not, I'm sorry, October 21st, they're going to be at the Oneida County Historical Society on Genesee Street in Utica. And the last little tidbit I got from them is that they can be reached on the web. If you're interested in following them, very simple, UticaIrish.org. And without further ado, no more other booths. Please enjoy.
West of the Great Lakes and beyond. The idea of the canal connecting
crossing the Hudson from Great Lakes was born shortly after the war. But the pressing issues of new government, War of 18 fell, and everything that was going on delayed action. But thanks to visionaries like DeWitt Clinton and James Geddes, the Erie Canal became a reality, with the first shovel full of dirt being turned right down the road in Rome, New York, on July 4th, 1817. Now imagine digging a ditch 4 feet deep, 40 feet wide, 363 miles long, with nothing but shovels, picks, and spades, through forests, swamps, and rock formations. It's hard to envision the enormity of this task without the use of the heavy equipment that we have today. While there was labor from nearby farms and villages, more would be needed. It became necessary to recruit immigrant labor, and the canal planners looked across the Atlantic to Ireland. A man named Canvas White, Whitestown, New York, an engineer as it would have been known at the time, traveled to England and studied the construction methods and materials. What he did was he walked over 2,000 miles of the canals in Europe, so he had a pretty good idea of what they needed to do. And in his travels, he came across J.J. McShane, a former prizefighter and canal contractor. Funny how those go together. McShane soon found himself in America, and over time, he recruited numerous Irish from America and Ireland to work on the canal. While the majority of the canal workers were native-born American, the Irish represented the largest single immigrant group working on the canal.
An American wake. Leaving one's country across the vast ocean in the days when the most expedient mode of travel was the sailing ship was indeed a daunting prospect. The families that were left behind in Ireland would most likely never see their departing loved ones again. The ships that sailed out of various ports were often referred to as coffin ships, with good reason. The unsanitary conditions aboard these vessels took their toll on their passengers, particularly on the weak, the young, and the old. Letters were often sent back to Ireland with terrible news that loved ones were lost on the long voyage across the Atlantic, or worse, no news at all.
From one of those letters, "My dear brother Liam, my sainted husband Donald has died crossing the ocean. The good captain of this boat is writing for me. The children, thanks be to God, are safe, but the three babies are down with dysentery. Bless young Donald. He sure is quite a man now, just like his dad. I still have a bit of money left, but that will soon be gone. I could take in laundry or find a family to work for in New York. I hope Donald's sister is still there. Ireland was bad, but without Donald, it's worse here. I have never been so afraid. Pray for your loving sister, Bridget O'Neill." From this was born the American way, a sending off marking the departure of loved ones with music, song, and dance.
Farewell to the groves of Shillelagh and the Shamrock. Farewell to the girls of old Ireland all around. And may their hearts be as merry as ever they could wish for, as far away over the ocean I am bound. My father is old and my mother's right feeble. To leave their own country, it would grieve their hearts so. Oh, the tears down their cheeks, in great floods they are rolling. To think that I must die upon some foreign shore. But what matters to me where my bones they may lie buried, if in peace and contentment I can spend my life. The green fields of America, they daily are calling. There I find an answer to my misery and strife. So
women who toiled 12 to 14 hours a day in what was then our Western wilderness.
What's your question, newspapers? Be cutting their capers while curing the vapors of scratch and the gout. With their magical potions, their salves and their lotions, upholding their notion, their mighty put out. You can tell the true physic to all that's pathetic, and pitch to that devil cramp, colic, and spleen. Oh, you'll find it, I think, if you take a big drink with your mouth to the brink of a jug of poutine. So take to the crater, the best thing in nature, for sinking your sorrows and raising your joys. Oh, what botheration of dose in the nation can give consolation like whiskey, boys? While a child in the cradle, me nurse with a ladle, was filling her mouth with a notion of pep, when a drop from the bottle fell into me throttle, I capered and scrambled clear out of her lap. On the floor I lay crawling and screaming and bawling. Father and mother soon came to the fore. All weeping and sighing, they thought I was dying, and found I was only a crying for more. In the crater, the best thing in nature, forsaking your sorrows and praising your joys. Oh Lord, how they chuckle with babes in their troubles, they only be suckled on whiskey, boys. Through my youthful aggression, through times of depression, my childhood's impression still clung to me mine. For at school or at college, the basis of knowledge, I never could go until whiskey combined. And as ever I'm growing, time's ever bestowing on errant quotation that flavor's so fine. And howe'er they may lecture on Jove and his nectar, itself is the only true liquid divine. So sink to the crater, the best thing in nature, for sinking your sorrows and raising your joys. Oh Lord, it's the right thing for courting and fighting. They're not so exciting as whiskey, boys. While digging the Erie, our lives they were dreary, our bodies were weary with our daily toil, with picking and shoveling and hacking and pulling the rocks and the trees from New York State soil. At the end of our labor, we get us the favor of Aaron's old flavor, that whiskey so fine. Our hearts would be pining, we'd soon set the singing and forget all our troubles with whiskey divine. So sink to the crater, the best thing in nature, for sinking your sorrows and raising your joys. From a jar or a kettle, it'll give you the metal, so drink up your bottles of whiskey, boys. Come, guess me this riddle, what beats I can fiddle, what's hotter than mustard and milder than cream? Well, that's what you would do, what's clearer than crystal, what's sweeter than honey and stronger than steam? What'll make the lame walk, what'll make the dumb talk? The elixir of life and philosopher's stone. Oh, what helped thee with Clinton to build the old Erie? 'Twas whiskey, me boy, from one night in New York. So the crater, the best thing in nature, for sinking your sorrows and raising your joys. Oh Lord, how I wonder if lightning and thunder weren't made from the plunder of whiskey, boys.
The Irish had their whiskey, but to get them through their day. But they also had their songs, songs from the homeland, and songs made up on the spot, like this one. I've been way down in deep that dirt, me feet is sore and me back does hurt. Me bones is creaking and me throat is dry. I'm like to die. I'm Jack O'Leary. I've been working the Erie, the mightiest of them all. The Irish contributed many other songs, words written to familiar Irish tunes and airs. Some songs reflected on the labor and toil aspect of the canal worker's life, while others seemingly spoke of the Irishman's thankfulness for being a part of this grand undertaking.
When I landed in sweet Philadelphia, the weather was pleasant and clear. I did not stay long in that city, yet quickly I shall let you hear. For I did not stay long in that city,
happened to be in the fall. I never used to sail in my rigging till I anchored upon the canal. So fare thee well, father and mother, and likewise old Ireland too. And fare thee well, sister and brother, so kindly I'll give you adieu. When I came to this wonderful empire, it filled me with the greatest surprise to see such a grand undertaking, all the lights I ne'er opened my eyes. To see a full 1,000 brave fellows at work among mountains so tall, to dig through the valley so level, through rocks for to cut a canal. So fare thee well, father and mother, and likewise, old Ireland too. And fare thee well, sister and brother, so kindly I bid you adieu. Well, I hired with them for a season, my monthly pay for to draw. And being in very good humor, I often sang Erin Go Bragh. Our provision, it was very plenty. To complain with no reason at all, I had money in every pocket while working upon the canal. So fare thee well, father and mother, and likewise old Ireland too. And fare thee well, sister and brother, so kindly I'll bid you adieu. Well, I learned to be very handy, to use both the shovel and spade. I learned the whole art of canaling, I think it an excellent trade. I learned to be very handy, although I was not very tall. I could handle the sprig of shillelagh with the best man on the canal. So fare thee well, father and mother, and likewise, old Ireland too. And fare thee well, sister and brother, so kindly I'll bid you adieu. When at night we all rest from our labor, be sure but our rent is all paid. We lay down our pick and our shovel, and likewise our axe and our spade. Playing music and joking together, with nothing our minds to enthrall. If there's happiness so in this wide world, I am sure it is on the canal. Woo! So fare thee well, father and mother, and likewise old Ireland too. And fare thee well, sister and brother, so kindly I'll give you adieu. Thank you.
our best. Disease was rampant amongst the canal workers, and the mosquito invested mountains in the swamp between Syracuse and Rochester was a source of malaria and misery, bringing death to many a canal worker. Just as bad were the smudge pots, the smoking leaves, bark, and twigs that were worn around the necks of the canal workers to fend off the flying fiends. The local labor pool would not work in the swamp, but the Irish eagerly attacked the job, under the leadership of James Geddes. Needy swamp water, mosquitoes, and leeches made their lives hell, wishing they had never heard of the hero. They turned their misery into a joke with this little ditty. We are digging a ditch to the mire, right up to our neck.
By heck.
And the mud is our principal fire, and our pants and our boots down our neck.
By heck.
And our pants and our boots and our boots down our neck. Living conditions were just as poor as the working conditions, and as work progressed along the canal, the Irish would eventually move the camps and shanty towns to the villages and towns along the way. It was not uncommon for a large Irish family to live in a 10-by-14 shanty, with the entire family sleeping on a single bed without the benefit of mattress or straw. The Irish were not always wealthy, believe it or not. The proclivity for drinking, rival county gang fights, strange language, accents, and rumored shenanigans put off the local populace. The clever Irish had fun with this notion, staging street fights being cousins and wives, with the children contributing to the commotion. Sending the townsfolk into shock while the Irish went back to the shanties, laughing at the spoof they had just played. They became known as the Wild Irish. Storyteller would sing ghost stories to the drivers and new hobbies. Youngsters new to the canal line. A convincing delivery and help from his fellow Irishman would soon have these neophytes terrorizing, running from the shanties from the Appalachian Sea just beyond the fire. Plus, there's a rite of passage for the new audience.
like hell on earth. Go walking about.
Canal inspired many works of historical fiction. Most notably are the works of Walt D. Evans of Boonville, New York, and most notable works regarding the canal life were Rome Hall and Erie Water. Rome Hall is probably the more well-known of the two works, having been made into plays in movies such as The Farmer Takes a Wife. The work features the Black River Canal, which came into use long after the old Erie Canal was done. The events portrayed in Erie Water take place in the time frame of the start of the Erie, with references to the politics involved and speaking to the logic of starting to dig in Rome. It's the story of a young man named Jerry Fowler who found his way west from Connecticut to Albany and Utica, where he lucks into a job in helping to build the Erie's locks. Within this work is an anecdote called The Wild Irish. Edmonds is the story of the Irish that has recently come on to aid in the digging to the Montezuma Swamp. The tale is a take on the Irish sense of humor, wherein the Irish laborers move the cook's privy to a more suitable location, while the privy was being occupied by the cook. Why else would you move it? As they pick up the privy and haul it away, they sing a song in Gaelic about a fallen hero being taken from the battlefield. The contractors overseeing the project come on to the scene and are momentarily mesmerized by their singing. As the Irish set the privy in place and realize it is occupied, they feign embarrassment for their actions. The cook is released from the privy, regains his composure, after which the newly arrived contractors read a letter from the heads of the project thanking them for their efforts. Of course, the Irishman does not understand a word of English. But the foreman of the Irish translates the correspondence from English Irish, mixing it all up and telling them that if they start slacking off, it will all be dealt with what the solid beef. That was the part from the Wild Irish in Omaha. I'm sorry. Erie Water.
The impact of the Erie Canal on the growth of New York State can't be overstated. Prior to the Erie's construction, Philadelphia was the economic and trade hub of America. But after the Erie was built, New York City quickly rose to prominence. Within 15 years of the opening of the Erie, New York was the busiest port in America. Moving tonnage was greater than Boston, Baltimore, and New Orleans combined. Towns along the canal were transformed overnight from outposts to major cities. Between 1820 and 1850, the population of Rochester multiplied by more than 20 times. Buffalo was a tiny trading post, struggling to become even a village as late as 1815, but it quickly became a port, a leading port to all points Midwest. Thousands of European immigrants arriving in New York made their way to the West, Michigan via the Erie through Buffalo. And the Irish assimilated well into the fabric of boom towns along the canal. They overcame the prejudice held against wondering who this fellow here is, I'm going to tell you the story. Andy Ryan. Out the eastern end of the Erie, Andy Ryan came. He was emigrated from County Tipperary with his parents at age 12 years old. Reportedly, Daddy jumped into the Erie canal to save a young girl from drowning. I guess his first taste of the Erie water. So. Soon after, though, he was trained as a lock tender on the canal. And you can see from the shoulders in this picture, that was a pretty kind of job, and he built a lot of muscle pushing those gates back and forth all day. And after that, the logical career progression was to open a saloon. Because he was good at handling the rough types that came into the saloon. And there he was spotted by Jake Corrin, who was the athletic director at RPI. He was impressed with Caddy's pugilistic ability and trained him as a prize fighter. His most famous fight was an 86 rounder against Joe Goss. It lasted near an hour and a half. And he defeated Joe for the bare knuckle championship of the world. He held the belt for a while, but there was another up and coming Irishman who took it away from him a few years later by the name of John L. Sullivan.
Later, he'd be employed to pull stranded barges during times of drought. The town much bigger than it was 200 years ago, but it bears desire Irish heritage proudly as the town logo features the Irish harp. As most of you realize, the traditional music and dances of Ireland had a significant impact and the influence on the development of traditional American music and dance. The first three tunes played in this program should sound as familiar to many non-musicians as Happy Birthday, having been used in many films, John Wayne, all kinds of stuff. The set dances of the Irish with four couples in a square are the forerunners of the American square dance, and the Virginia Reel Vaughan dance is the same dance as the Irish haymaker shape. The songs and ballads of the Irish and Scots Irish made their way across the Atlantic through the Canadian Maritime, New England, New York, and into the Appalachian ballad tradition. One such song, Sally Gardens, in Ireland transformed from a love song to a murder ballad across the ocean, called Down by the Willow Garden, which is not really a stretch once you realize that willow tree is called the Sally Tree in Ireland. So they're really the same song, only they got a little darker when they crossed the ocean.
Thank you.
drove in Buffalo for the need for entertainment. Of course, Edwin Ned Christie appeared on the scene as a minstrel performing in Buffalo's newly built tavern and saloon. He went on to form the Christie's Minstrels, employing an Irish fiddler named Richard Kennedy. The Christies went on to appear in New York City and across the South. They specialized in the music of Stephen Foster and popularized blackface. Blackface performance. That's how much more popular. I guess, I know.
Protest called boycott was named after the Irish ostracized 19th century British land agent, Charles Boycott. Finally, the familiar phrase, so long, meaning goodbye, had its Irish root as swan, also meaning farewell, goodbye. So with that, I want to say, Gudramahagat, thank you. Thank you for being a wonderful audience. We hope you found this both entertaining and educational. There are many internet resources available to learn more about the rich history of the Erie Canal and the contribution that it's made to the America. But by far, the best resources are our local library. They did a lot of lot of time, and I hear it.